Hi, we're almost at the end of the first week, and we have seen a lot of topics. To get you ready for the homework, I will summarize the most important content of the past week for you. This week was all about functions and their properties. We started with a general definition. A function can be seen as a machine that takes its input from a certain set, called the domain, and then produces an output that ends up in a set called the codomain. Remember that we only considered functions that send real numbers to real numbers. So the codomain can always be chosen to be R. However, the domain does not have to be all real numbers. Given the context, it may be more natural to restrict the domain, and sometimes the defining formulas are simply not defined for certain input values. Once the domain is chosen, you can look at the range, the set of values that the function can attain. This set can be smaller than the full codomain. We've seen four ways to describe a function: by means of a formula, using a table, using a graph, and in words. It's important that you can switch between these types of description. We then considered specific types of functions, starting with polynomial functions. Polynomial functions can be constructed from a variable and a set of numbers using only addition and multiplication. Any polynomial can be put into its standard form, in which no brackets occur anymore, every power of x occurs once, and the terms are ordered from high power to low. The highest occurring power in standard form is called the degree. As we have seen, the degree determines the behavior of the polynomial function as x grows large. Also, the higher the degree, the more complicated the function and its graph may behave. It's important to understand the behavior of polynomial functions of low degree. Polynomial functions of degree 0 are of the form p of x equals a. They're constant functions. Polynomials of degree 1 have standard form a times x plus b. The graph is a straight line with slope a and y-intercept b. Polynomial functions of degree 2, also called quadratic functions, are of the form a times x squared plus bx plus c. The graph of any such function is a parabola. It's often useful, when possible, to rewrite a quadratic function in factorized form: a times x minus p times x minus q. P and q are the x values where the graph intersects the horizontal axis. Another useful form is the complete square form: a times x minus r squared plus s. R and s are precisely the coordinates of the vertex of the parabola. The second class of functions that we considered are rational functions. These are precisely the functions that can be constructed from a variable and a set of numbers using addition, multiplication, and division. Any rational function can be written as a quotient of two polynomials. In the exercises, you saw how to do this. The graph of a rational function may have asymptotes, straight lines that are approached by the graph. Vertical asymptotes, where the function grows to plus or minus infinity, can occur at x values for which the denominator vanishes. Be careful though. If the numerator vanishes as well, an asymptote may be absent. Horizontal asymptotes occur precisely if a function tends to a constant for x much larger or much smaller than zero. The common technique to find such asymptotes is to divide numerator and denominator by the highest power of x occurring in the denominator. Then you see clearly what happens as x grows large. The final class of functions that we considered are the functions of the form x to the power a, the so-called power functions. The domain depends on a. All power functions are defined for x bigger than 0. However, if x equals 0, x to the power a is only defined for positive a. For negative x, it's more complicated. There is no problem if a is an integer. For non-integer a, it's usually not defined. But there are exceptions, like x to the power 1/3. For the graphs of power functions, we have the following in general. If a is bigger than 0, it is increasing for positive x. The larger the exponent, the faster it grows for large x. For a smaller than 0, the graph is decreasing. In this case, we have the smaller a, the closer to 0 from large x. For integer exponents, the graphs have symmetry properties. They are line symmetric in the y-axis if a is even, and point symmetric in the origin if a is odd. Finally, power functions obey certain rules of calculation that you should know. X to the power a times x to the power b equals x to the power a plus b. X to the power a divided by x to the power b equals x to the power a minus b. X to the power a to the power b is equal to x to the power a times b. And finally, x times y to the power a equals x to the power a times y to the power a. If x and y are positive, these rules hold for all a and b. Be careful for other values of x and y. Then, problems may arise for negative and non-integer exponents. All the functions that we treated share a property. They are continuous on their maximal domain. Roughly, a function f is called continuous if the following holds. If you can change x by a small amount within the domain of f, fx will also change by a small amount. In particular, the function values cannot jump. If f and x are continuous functions, then so is their sum, product, and quotients, whenever those are defined. If a continuous function is defined on an interval from a to b, including a and b, then we will attain all values between fa and fb. This is called the intermediate value property. Intuitively, it means that you can draw the graph on the interval without lifting your pen. You should be aware that not all functions are continuous. For example, functions that have graphs with jumps. Such functions have to be defined piecewise using different formulas on different intervals. Conversely, given such a piecewise defined function, you should be able to tell whether it has jumps or not. These were the main topics of this week. Good luck with your homework.